Jeannie has agreed to read our scripture for us today. It's from Titus.
And I think I can do it loudly enough. After all, God's saving kindness has appeared for the benefit of all people. It trains us to avoid ungodly lives filled with worldly desires so that we can live self-controlled, moral, and godly lives in this present world. At the same time, we can expect what we hope for, the appearance of the glory of our great Savior and God, Jesus Christ. He gave himself for us to set us free from every sin and to cleanse us so that we can be his special people who are enthusiastic about doing good things. Tell these things to the believers, encourage and correct them using your full authority. Don't let anyone ignore you. I remind believers to willingly place themselves under the authority of government officials. Believers should obey them and be ready to help them with every good thing they do. Believers shouldn't curse anyone or be quarrelsome, but they should be gentle and show courtesy to everyone.
No, that's it.
Oh, oops, sorry.
Those are interesting verses from the book of Titus. Most people don't read from Titus very often, and you should. It's only three chapters. You can sit down and read the whole thing all at once. But it's encouraging words, but it's also words that are hard to hear because it's telling us how to do things. I've been thinking all week about the very notion that if there's a preacher you listen to and you agree with everything they say and you really like everything they say, they aren't probably preaching God's word. Because preaching God's word means you get poked every once in a while, or in my case, kicked. So if we are hearing God's word, we're actually going to get prodded a little bit. In Titus, it uses the term encourage people. And sometimes just an encouragement is enough. Not, you don't have to poke. But sometimes things will poke us because we, oh, I'm doing that. It says we're not to be judgmental, not to condemn people. That's really hard. And I know there are some people who have overcome that tendency. But it's really hard not to judge others, condemn them, find fault with them. And I wonder if we spend as much time looking for people's good points, if it would be a better world. You know, when somebody's driving in front of you and they don't put their signal on, my tendency used to be to speak a little more loudly and explain they should have signaled. And now I try to remember, maybe they've just had bad news. You know, maybe there's something going on in their lives that turning on the turn signal isn't important. And we have to be a little more gentle. Courtesy to everyone, it says, is the very last words of what Jeannie read in chapter 3, verse 2. Courtesy to everyone. It's a real challenge that we're given from Titus, because not only does it say we need to keep ourselves pure in the world, it's very easy to get sucked into the whirlwind of what the world is doing. It's easy to get sucked into the whirlwind of the sadness and the gloom that the world is full of. Whether you're hearing news about Gaza or about Afghanistan, and now they've banned women's sports, so that those women who were in the Olympics are now banned from going to, back to Afghanistan. They'll be put in jail. You can really get upset if you listen to all the stuff that's going on. But somehow we need to rise above that, not to disregard it, but to rise above it, because there is hope. It says we have hope because we expect the coming of Jesus, our great God and Savior. And it's not just the end of the world that's talking about. Lots of people spend a lot of time thinking about the end of the world, which can also put you into depression. But it's that Jesus comes to us every moment of every day. In other words, Jesus never leaves us. And we need that encouragement often when something really big happens in our life that throws us for a loop. We need to remember not that Jesus is absent. We sometimes blame God for what happens. But instead, Jesus is with us. No matter how bad it is, and I'm not saying that tritely. I'm not trying to say that we can get through everything with a smile on our face. I think we can get through anything, but we won't necessarily have a smile on our face as we go through. Psalm 23, that most of us memorized decades and decades ago, even though I walk, and it says, through the valley of the shadow of death. Doesn't say we walk in it or that we get stuck in it. It says we walk through it. And so this encouragement that we have in the book of Titus is that we have a great expectation. We have hope of the presence of Jesus Christ within us. Not only to get us through things, but to help us and protect us from some of the bad things that this world has to offer. Yesterday and today, I heard in the news that counselors and doctors are seeing a great increase in the number of young people who are experiencing psychosis induced by marijuana. And it's one of those things. It's now legal, so people can use it, except you're not supposed to use it before you're 19, except that that's the law, that's not the practice. And I know that one of the arguments against legalizing marijuana way back was that the human brain, believe it or not, isn't actually finished maturing until you're about 21. That's why teenagers are such a pain in the neck, because they haven't matured yet. I say that because my grandson's here, and he's still a teenager. But they said that the marijuana is known to affect the brain, and to affect the brain before it matures can affect the way it does mature. And now the evidence is out there that young people are using, and they're getting psychosis, which is a disruption of the way the brain works. We need to pray for our young people and for others. That's an important thing. The last thought I want to leave with you is that I cannot do it alone. I love this picture that I have because it's at least three different people. And it's probably more. I think maybe it is actually six people. And the six people putting their hands together can form a heart. Now, I can form a heart all by myself, but it's pretty small. Where if you get six people doing it, it's big. We aren't expected to do it in our own, even though our society tells us you've got to be independent. Rubbish. I am not independent of anything because I am dependent upon my Savior. And so when someone can come along and give me a help or an encouragement or a good piece of advice, instead of getting my back up, I should get my back down and accept it with the joy of the Lord. Because I need you. I need your wisdom. I need your advice. Because even though I'm old, most of you in this room are even older, which means you have experience that I don't have. You have wisdom that I don't have. We do need each other. It can be as simple as it's nice to have somebody bring your food to your table, rather than you trying to get up there with your walker and balancing plates and all that kind of, right? So we need each other from simple things like getting our food to cleaning our rooms to getting laundry done. All of these simple things that happen every week and every day, we can be blessed by the fact that there are others in our lives who are helping us. So, I teach and I live contrary to our culture. I do not intend to be independent. I depend to live in community because I need you, and hopefully some days maybe even need me. So that together we are better. The Bible actually says that. If two walk together and one falls in the ditch, the other one can help them get out, right? And so the Bible itself teaches that we are not to walk alone. We walk with others. And especially if you get to the point where you can't walk at all, and you actually may need someone to push you. It's wonderful, these words from Titus, even though they challenge us to behave, how to behave correctly, but also the encouragement that we have hope in the presence of Jesus, and that we know we are not alone. We live in God's world, not in our world. Amen. Arrangement too. Let us spend time in prayer. We thank you, God, that you always give us opportunity to serve others, whether it's to be encouraging with a smile, whether it's to help lift something or carry something, to walk with someone and lift their load of companionship. All of these things, we thank you, O God. And we thank you that you are present with us. Encourage us, help us to serve others, for in that way we demonstrate our love for you, and we can serve you because all people in the world are your children. And whenever we do it to the least of those in the world, we do it for you. We pray, O God, for those that we remember today. We remember Don and Ed. We lift up to you family and friends and acquaintances. Encourage them, help them, give them hope in a life that does not end but goes on and on through your love and through your kindness. We pray, O God, for those today who don't have hope or are struggling to find hope. We thank you that your presence in this world brings hope. The glory of your creation, the wonder of sunrises and sunsets, of the breeze that blows and carries fresh air, of all the things around us that say, you are present with us, we are not alone. We thank you, O God. And so together we share the prayer that Jesus gave to us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. others, so that you may know the joy of the Lord, that you may share the joy of the Lord, and that the Lord may have joy with you. The peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.